In this video, we are diving deep into live variable analysis, a core concept in compiler optimizations. By the end of this video, you will have crystal clear understanding of what live variables are, why they are essential, and how to analyze them step by step. Let's get started. First thing first, what exactly is live variable? A variable is considered live at a programming point if its current value is used later in any branch of code without being redefined. Otherwise, it is dead. Here, a program point refers to a specific location in the program execution, such as the boundary of a basic block, entry or exit, or an individual instruction, or the position between two consecutive instructions. Let's understand the definition of live variable using a few examples. In these examples, we have a program point P and we need to determine if a variable V is live at P or not. In the first example, we have three branches of code. The first branch has no instructions that read or write variable V. The second branch only writes to V. The third branch first writes to V and then reads it. Thus, at P, the variable is not live because its current value is never used in any of the three branches. In the second example, the setup is similar, but in the third branch, a read precedes the write. In this case, the variable V is live at P because its value at P is read or used by the third branch. Finally, in the last example, we have a single branch with the instruction V equals to V plus 3. This makes V live at P because we first read V's value before overwriting it. I hope these examples clarify what is meant by a live variable. Based on these examples, we can redefine live variable at point P as follows. A variable V is live at P if its value at P is read by any of the branches of code after P. You might be wondering, why is live variable important? Why do we care about live variables? Great question. There are three key benefits of live variable analysis. First, register allocation. Your CPU has limited number of registers, but they provide best speed optimization. Live variable analysis helps determine which variables to keep in these limited CPU registers, making our program more efficient. Second, dead code elimination. If a variable is not live, we can simply remove it, making our code smaller in size. Third, optimize memory usage. Think of live variable analysis as an offline garbage collector. By optimizing code during compilation, it makes program consume significantly less memory, since memory access is one of the slowest operations for a CPU. This can potentially enhance program speed. Let's break down how live variable analysis work. The input to This algorithm is the control flow graph, and the output will be in and out set for each basic block B. Step 1, initialization. We start by initializing the in and out sets for each basic block B as empty. This means that initially no variables are considered live for any block. Step 2. Updating the local data flow variables for each basic block. The gen set, which contains the variables used in the basic block B before being redefined. The kill set, which contains the variables that are redefined in basic block B. Step 3. Iterative updates for global data flow variables. Now, we iteratively update the in and out sets for each basic block B until they stabilize, meaning they are no longer changed. The out set for a basic block B is the union of the in sets of all of its successor blocks. This means that the outset contains all the live variables that can be reached from the current block through its successor. The inset for a basic block B is the union of the gen set of B and the variables from the outset that are not killed by the block. This ensures that variables that are live and carried over from other blocks do not redefine in the current blocks are included. If you still have questions about how to calculate these variables, don't worry. Next, I will walk you through an example where we will apply each of these steps. This example will make everything crystal clear as we go through it together. Please stay till the end of this video as we will also discuss how to use in and out sets for dead code elimination. In this example, we are working with a control flow graph. As explained in a previous video, a control flow graph consists of basic blocks. In this case, there are 7 basic blocks, which I have numbered for convenience. To perform live variable analysis, the first step is to compute the local data flow variables for each block. Recall that gen B is the set of variables used in block B before being redefined, while kill B is the set of variables defined within block B. Let's start with block 1. In block 1, no variables are used before being redefined. So, gen 1 is an empty set. You might be wondering about the last instruction where I and j are used. You are right to notice that. But since they are not used before their redefinition, they are excluded from gen set. However, the variables I, j, k, and p are defined in block 1. So, they are included in kill 1 set. Now, moving to block 2. Here, the variables I and j are used before any redefinition occurs. So, we include I and J in Gen 2. Since no variables are defined in block 2, kill 2 is an empty set. In block 3, the variables I, J and K are used before redefined. So they are included in Gen 3 set. Additionally, I and J are defined in this block, so they are added in kill 3. By now, I hope you have a clear understanding of gen and kill sets. These sets form the basis for live variable analysis. To save time, I will now quickly compute the gen and kill sets for all 7 basic blocks. The next step is to initialize the global data flow variables in B and out B as empty sets for every basic block B. After that, we iteratively compute these sets until their values converge, meaning they remain the same across consecutive iterations. To simplify calculation and speed up convergence, we start from the last basic block and move upward towards the first block. While this is not mandatory, it often helps the system stabilize more quickly. Recall, out B is calculated as the union of in S set for all successor S of block B. For block 7, there are no successors because no links go out of it. So out 7 is an empty set. In B is then calculated as the union of gen B and the difference between out B and kill B. In block 7, gen 7 include Q. Since both out 7 and kill 7 are empty sets, in 7 contains only Q. For block 6, out 6 contains Q, which come from in 7, its only successor. In 6 is the union of gen 6, which is empty set, and the difference between out 6 and kill 6. Both out 6 and kill 6 contain Q, so their difference is an empty set, leaving in 6 empty. For block 5, out 5 contains Q, which comes from in 7 of a successor. In 5 is calculated as the union of gen 5, which includes P and I, and the difference between out 5 and kill 5. Since out 5 contains Q and kill 5 contains P and Q, the set difference out 5 minus kill 5 result in an empty set. Therefore, in 5 contains P and I only. Block 4 has 2 successors, block 6 and block 5. Out 4 is the union of in 6 and in 5, which result in the set P and I. In 4 is then computed as the union of gen 4, which contains P and I, and the difference between out 4 and kill 4. Since out 4 is already empty, the result does not depend on kill 4. Therefore, in 4 contains P and I. Block 3 is part of a loop. Its successor is block 2, whose in and out sets have not yet been computed. This demonstrates why multiple iterations are necessary. In the first iteration, out3 will be an empty set. In3 is union of gen3, which contains ijk, and the difference between out3 and kill3. Since out3 is empty, in3 simply contains I, J, and K. By now, I hope you have a good understanding of how we compute the in and out sets. Please keep in mind the how to compute difference of two sets. To save time, I will skip to the final result after completing the process of all blocks. After two iterations, the global data flow variables converge and stop changing. You will notice that in the second iteration, block 3 information is updated, reflecting the contributions from its successors. By the third iteration, no further changes occur. So we are stopping at second iteration. The next step is to use this table to identify and eliminate unnecessary variables. Please let me first copy the table above and remove everything else so that I can calculate the dead variables easily. So the rule is, if a variable appears in the in B set but not in the out B set, it means the variable is live at the start of the block but becomes dead after the block ends. This allows us to safely remove it at the exit of that block, since its value will no longer be needed in the program. For example, in this case, in block 7, the variable q is present in the in set but not in the outset. Therefore, Q can be safely removed from the memory at the exit of block 7. In block 5, the inset contains P and I, and the outset does not contain either of these variables. Hence, both P and I can be safely removed at the exit of block 5. For block 3, the variable I, J, K are part of the inset. However, J and K are not included in the outset, meaning they become dead after the block's end. Therefore, J and K can be removed at the exit of block 3. But I cannot be removed because it remains live beyond this point. That concludes this video. I hope it has clarified the concept of live variable analysis and helped you understand how to eliminate unnecessary variables. If you found this video helpful, please support this channel so that I can continue making more videos. See you in the next video. Take care and bye.